Welcome to part 2 of the video on corporate governance. Now we have discussed in the earlier part what is corporate governance. We have tried to define it. We have tried to understand through various scams how if corporate governance is not followed, it can have so many repercussions on the entire society, on the company, in the way company is being followed. We have seen the case of British Petroleum, wherein because of the company trying to save $1 million on a daily basis, it cost the entire nation and the world probably $100 billion. So one single wrong decision of the board of directors, one single wrong decision of the CEO of the company or the management of the company can have serious repercussions. Now we'll be continuing with part 2 of this particular video and trying to understand the various other components that are part of corporate governance. Now look at this quote from Spider-Man. This particular movie had a great quote: with great power comes great responsibility. Now, in most of the countries, you'll find out that in today's date, the government is taking a back seat and it is asking the private companies to take charge. They are the biggest, the private companies are the biggest employment generators inside the particular country. These private companies are the biggest wealth generators in the company. And these companies are also helping a lot in the production, supply and demand of the particular company. They are contributing a lot to the GDP of the company. Now, they have been given a lot of power because of all these things they are able to do. They have assumed a lot of power, and that power can go uncontrolled. So there must be some rules and regulations. There must be some particular means through which the government can control these companies. And that is where corporate governance comes in. Now, concept of corporate governance is basically wherein we have the management of the particular company and the board of the particular company. Now, management and board, if you consider as one particular entity, they are answerable. The management and the board is answerable to all the stakeholders. Now, we have discussed stakeholders in an earlier chapter. We'll try to discuss it once again. Who are the various stakeholders? Anybody who has business interest, who gets affected by the operations of a particular company, is a stakeholder. For example, the financial institutions, they have invested money into the particular company, so they would be interested in the business. The lenders of the particular business who have supplied money, who have supplied materials and essentials are interested in the company. Suppliers of the company are interested in the company. Customers are also stakeholders in the company because they are going to buy those companies products. Investors are the stakeholders, the general public at large. If there is an accident which happens in a particular company, it can affect the general public also, which is staying 2 kilometers, 5 kilometers away. Even those can get affected. So even they are stakeholders. The government is also another stakeholder. And the majority of the stakeholder is the shareholders who have actually invested their hard-earned money into the operations of the company. So these are all stakeholders. Now, any business has to ensure that they do justice to all the stakeholders. To the dominant shareholders, the top particular visual you can see, you have to take their decisions. You have to take their approval of the shareholders for various business decisions. You have to call for annual general meetings. You have to take board appointments, and only then you have to or a company can do all those things with respect to dominant shareholders. For small investors, the company should disclose the norms, the regulatory protection must be there. For suppliers, the company should ensure that the sales of good laws is being followed. For the government and public at large, companies required to function in public interest. It should be doing good work for the public at large. It should not be involved in any practice which can be negative for the particular company and the for the entire society at large. For the creditors, it should help in participation in winding of the company, recovery statutes and public financial institutions. So the company must follow all the rules and regulations which the creditors can get happy about. For the company, it is also important that they look after the customers and consumers through various consumer protection laws, because consumerism is also growing. And for the employees, the company has to ensure that labor law contractual mechanisms are totally being followed. Now, all these activities of a particular company is being directed or is being controlled by the board of directors. board of directors example is being provided over here. A board of director, a director can have non-executive director, can have the managing director, will have a particular chairman, will have a commercial director, a non-executive directors will be in multiple numbers. We will have managing director and executive directors for finance, for marketing, for HR, for all those. We'll have company secretaries over there, we'll be having auditors, we'll be having information system director. So these are all the people who are composed in a board of director. Now we'll just spend a little amount of time to understand how the board of director functions. Now the shareholders, as we have discussed in the earlier chapter, are literally the owners of the particular company, because they have invested their hard-earned money into the particular company. Now if I have invested in a particular company, the company does not give me a call on a daily basis or on a yearly basis or on a weekly basis to tell me how the company is functioning. So I have entrusted, as a shareholder, I have entrusted the board of directors, which is the circle over here, and the management of the company, which is the triangle, to ensure that the company is functioning in the right way as is expected from me. Now the board of directors, the circle part, will have a chairman. Suppose there are 16 members, 1-6 members in a particular board of directors team, it will have a chairman. It will have some amount of non-executive directors. We have to understand what is a non-executive director. A non-executive director is somebody who is outside of the particular company. If you look at this particular triangle, we'll find out the people who are inside this particular triangle will be the executive directors, which are part of the board, the circle. And the other one is the non-executive directors. Basically, these are not on the rolls of the company. They are not taking salary as an employee of the company. They just are the part of the board. They are just trying to be independent in nature and keep on providing their important feedback to the company. So these people are there for managing the operations of the company. And I, the shareholder of the company, have authorized these people to run the business smoothly. According to the laws and regulations, according to being ethically standard, and all those things have to be followed is what my expectation is from the company. Now, executive directors are basically the inside directors. These are people from inside of the company who are there in the board of directors. They determine the strategy and manage day-to-day operations. CEO is the overall charge of the executive directors. For all the executive directors you can have in a particular board of director, the CEO is the top head. Now, non-executive directors are basically outside directors. They are independent people, judgment and outside experience and objectivity. They bring outside experience and objectivity to the particular business. They represent the interest of the shareholders, maybe executives of other firms. The chairman of the board should be elected as the NEDs, from the NEDs. In the most ideal of scenarios, the chairman should be a non-executive director, so that the board is not able to influence the operations of the company, or the CEO is not able to affect the operations of the particular company. Now let me just take one more minute to explain what I'm trying to talk over here. Now if you look at the particular company, suppose the CEO and chairman, CEO is the person who is the employee of the company, the top of all the executive directors. Imagine the tip of this particular triangle, the top end side, he is the CEO of the particular company. If the CEO and chairman are one and the same person, then there is a lot of problems that can happen. The CEO can try to force his opinion on everybody. He will take the company in a different direction, and maybe that might not be the right direction. And therefore, to check the activities of the CEO, we have the board of directors. Some of the members of the board of directors are from outside the company. The reason being that if the CEO is doing something wrong, these board of directors, these team of 16-20 people will be questioning the CEO of the company. Also, when the particular CEO has behaved in a wrong way, I, as the shareholder of the company, when I come to know about it, can also question and fire the CEO. And there is where the beauty of corporate governance lies, that if the CEO is under the fear that the board of directors can fire him, or the shareholder can also ask questions, then he will try to behave in a proper way, in a way that is beneficial for all the entities which are involved in the particular company.